Ms. Sania Mirza is here with us. Can we have a good round of applause? I now call upon the chair for Hyderabad chapter Young Indians, Mr. Bhaven, Shah, to come up on stage and take the proceedings.
The applause for Sania Mirza wasn't loud enough. Can you do it one more time? Sania Mirza has a very tight schedule, and she is very graciously, in spite of her very, very busy schedule and the tournaments and travel coming up. In fact, she's just taking a flight in the next hour and a half. She has graciously agreed to be here, so you know we are very privileged and honored to have her here. And first of all, I would like to say a belated happy birthday to you, Sania.
Thank you.
last week, November 15, was your birthday. And I mean, Sania does not need any introduction. I mean, she's an Arjuna Award winner, Padma Shri, gold at Asian Games, Commonwealth, Afro Asian. And then recently the World Tour Finals. So amazing list of accomplishment, and the list just keeps on growing day by day. So really congratulations to you, Sania.
Thank you.
And we're just gonna make it interactive, just Q&A, and just because we have a brief time period. So the question I'll just ask, Sania, you've achieved so much. What keeps you going after achieving so much?
Well, first of all, good afternoon, everyone. Great to be here. Well, I do it because I love the sport. I never picked up a tennis racket because for fame or money, or you know, it was because we love tennis and as a family, and we still love tennis. And so everything that comes with it is a bonus, of course, but the joy of playing and the joy of competing is something that keeps me going.
Great, great. Now, taking a second to go back, before all this started, you can just walk us through your early days. You know, what was it like when you picked up tennis, or you thought about tennis, and what was that early phase like?
Well, when I picked up tennis, I mean, I guess everyone knows my age, so I can say I'm 28 years old, and I was
28 years young.
I'm 28 years young. I turned 28 last week, but I started playing when I was 6. So this is pretty much what I've done all my life, and I don't know anything else. And so for the first couple of years, it was fine. But Hyderabad at that point was a very, very small city. It was unheard of a girl playing tennis and dreaming to play Wimbledon one day, and we were laughed at by our own family, I mean uncles and aunts, and I got the usual, I'm sure girls can connect with that, ki kali ho jayegi or shadi kaun karega, and you know, how shorts pehen ke kaise ladko ke saath khelegi. I mean, there was obviously the usual that I think every or most girls face in this country. And I was very lucky, obviously, to have parents who believed, and who had parents who, you know, who obviously had a much broader mind than just tanning and, you know, worrying about an 8-year-old getting married when she's 18. So, it was about that. And I played in Hyderabad at a time when we didn't have facilities. We used to play, believe it or not, courts made out of cow dung. So it used to really, because those were the cheapest courts to make, and those were the the only courts that they were, except this one hard court which we had all the way in Sikandarabad. I used to live in Panjagutta at that time. So it was not easy, to come out of facilities like that, and that's why it's much harder to come out of this part of the world into a sport which is so global, and where other people are, you know, have the Nick Bollettieri's training them, and you're playing on, you know, cow crap. So, but It's been a great journey. I mean, 22 years of my life, and I wouldn't change it. You know, if I could relive it again, I wouldn't change a thing.
Okay, that's very good. You hear about, you know, the. You hear about the stories of you know, Serbian Novak Djokovic, who basically played tennis in the swimming pool, right? But these trials and tribulations that what you have gone through, people don't know that the early years, so even India didn't have these kind of facilities.
Yeah, I mean, look, we you know, I always say this, we, you know, we are a cricketing nation, we're not a sporting nation, and you know, people love cricket, and even today, I mean, of course it's changed a lot over the last 20 years, but even today, you know, for a girl to come out and say, oh yeah, you know, I used to get tanned like, oh, do you think she's ever going to be Martina Hingis? So for me, it was the most special day when I actually beat Martina Hingis, you know. So it was stuff like that. So, you know, people don't believe. They believe that if you are a professional athlete, either you have to be a cricketer from this part of the world or you're not. You know, it's always treated as something, you know, that is very regular, and that's not really your main profession. It's almost like, no, what do you really do? Like, I've had questions like that. I said, I'm a tennis player. They say, yeah, but what's your real job, you know? I'm like, well, that is my real job. So, yeah, and it's not easy. It's not easy to come out of this part of the world, and it's not easy to be a girl and to be, you know, especially from a small city, to try and fight odds in a sport that is so global and played over, you know, 200 countries.
When you, you know, started playing tennis, and at that time you mentioned that, you know, the women, I mean, forget, tennis itself was not a big prominent sport, and now even the women, less than the number of women playing it. And all these, in spite of all these constraints and all these, you know, negative criticism, what made you continue? Because anybody else would have probably chosen a different path at that time.
Probably. I mean, I, you know, I can't say that, oh, at six I knew I wanted to be a tennis player. Of course, there were times when, you know, I didn't want to wake up in the morning and I was like, oh, I mean, let me choose something easier, you know, like, I don't know, cooking or, but I don't know, I'm sorry, it's not easier because I don't know how to cook one thing, but, I think my parents really were the reason that I kept continuing, because they were the ones that never let negative things affect me until today, you know. They, when I have a problem or if I have something negative, if I feel down, I go to my mom and I'm like, mom, and my mom's like, who cares, you know, people baat to karte nahi, 28 saal se kar rahe. That's the, you know, thing my mom has, and that's very important for as young people, you know, for us to understand, because I think that we go by society a lot, and we go by culture and a certain society stigma that what a person should do or shouldn't do, and especially girls, what a girl should do and shouldn't do, what should she wear and what shouldn't she wear. I think that you have to believe that if you feel you're doing the right thing and you believe in yourself, I think that you do it. I mean, you know, well, if it doesn't work out, tough, do something else after that, but at least you won't regret that you know, stopped it because a person who's probably you're never going to meet again said something to you.
Yeah, and then coming out of that early days, in 2009, I believe, in Australian Open, you made a debut, and then you took everybody, I think before that only.
Yeah, I made a debut in 2005, actually.
2005,
yeah.
Yes, sorry. So, you made a debut, and then you took everybody, you know, by storm, because, first of all, your tremendous forehand, that was a killer. I mean, the people just didn't have any answer to your forehands. But, and after that, I mean, you just, you know, kept winning, and you did so many good things. I mean, what was that phase like? What was going through your mind when you came into that scene and started
being so well? You know, when you're 18, not much goes through your mind, I promise you. You kind of just see the ball and you hit it, and that's really what happens. And obviously, I had I still have it, I guess. I put my foot in my mouth so many times. I mean, I've gotten in trouble, but that's how I believe in living, that I should say what comes to my heart and, you know, what I believe in. And doesn't go down well with a lot of people sometimes. So, but that's their problem, not mine, I guess. And at 18, you know, you just play, you enjoy, you love the fact that you're out there competing with the Serena Williams and the Venus Williams of the world, where you've watched them grow up, you know, like you watched them growing up and you watched Wimbledon center court, and you can't believe that you're on that center court and you're competing there. So it's like a dream come true, you know, it's like a fairy tale that's happening, all those sacrifices come back that you've been putting in for years and years, and you finally, and not just you, you know, your parents. I mean, you know, my parents have gone, you know, they used to skip meals so that we had money to travel. You know, there's so many things that used to happen. I mean, I don't want to sound like a rags to riches, but that's really what happens. I mean, tennis is an expensive sport to play. So, yeah, it was a dream come true, and, you know, still living that dream. So, you know, blessed.
Yeah, that's fantastic to, you know, have you hear that you're living your dream, and it does sound like it, but it was not easy. It has not been easy, and especially there was a time when I think you had to go through surgeries, and there was a time when there was a lull in your performance, and there were a lot of critics who were saying that, you know, she doesn't have the all-around sports, and she should give up sport, or she should retire, something like that, and that must have been very, very difficult.
Actually, the amazing part about these critics is I don't think any one of them would have ever held a cricket bat or a tennis racket in their lives. I mean, and that's what makes it amazing is that I'm like, why am I playing and you're sitting on the couch, you know, like, you know, but, you know, that's life. I mean, I guess, see, when you're a celebrity, we become, you know, there's a lot of, obviously, there's a lot of media, there's a lot of, I mean, there's 24 news channels, there's, I don't even know how many hundreds they have to take, they have to keep making breaking news, and, you know, we are obviously, you know, great targets for that. We put an if to a but, and, you know, all of a sudden it's like, oh my God, you know, she said this or he said this. So, but, you know, I've been pretty, I mean, thankfully, I have a pretty thick skin, you know, so it doesn't affect me what people say, because otherwise I wouldn't have been able to live that I have lived. And like I said, I wouldn't change a thing in my life, and you just have to believe in yourself. For me, yes, dealing with those three surgeries was very hard emotionally, but dealing with the critics, I mean, you know, critics, they come and go. One day, you know, you lose a match, all of a sudden you're the biggest loser in the world, and then the next day you win, and those guys are your biggest fans in the world. That's just the way it works, you know. If you come from an emotional country like we do, as a star, you have to learn how to deal with very emotional people. Some rational, some very, very irrational.
Yeah, and what you, I mean, I'm sure that you know, you had a lot of conversations with yourself also at that time, and. The belief that you have now, definitely you are more confident, but at that time there was a period of vulnerability, you think, or you were always like, you know, I really don't care, I mean, let them say whatever they want?
No, I thought I was going to stop playing tennis, but it wasn't because of the critics. I was going to stop because of my body. You know, in 2010, I was hurt for about 6 months. That's the year I got married, and, you know, for those 6 months, I could not, believe it or not, I was handicapped. I couldn't comb my hair, I couldn't change my own clothes. And so playing tennis was a very far-fetched thought at that point, and I just wanted to be okay. You know, as athletes, we think we're so invincible that people cannot, you know, like that we're the healthiest people around, but we're not. We're putting our bodies under so much pressure day in and day out, you know, that we are actually very vulnerable to a lot of injuries. And so for me, those 6 months were the hardest part of my life, because I thought at the Commonwealth Games that happened in Delhi, actually I was going to announce my retirement at the end of the year, and I was preparing for that. So I was, you know, I was married and I was happy. I was like, okay, fine, this is, you know, great, I'm going to cook and I'm going to, you know, travel with my husband and whatever. But, you know, destiny, things changed. You know, my wrist started feeling better. I went to Wimbledon, I was still about 60 in the world. So I was like, oh, okay, you know, let me just go there. And Shah was playing there actually against England at the time. So I said, oh, okay, it'll be great. You know, you're playing as well, I'll just play. It was literally like that. And I said, my wrist is not hurting so much, so let me just pop a few painkillers and just play. And one thing led to the other, and the next thing I knew, I was playing for a gold medal match at the Commonwealth Games. And, you know, I ended up winning. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah, no, and then I ended up winning two medals there, went to Asian Games, won two medals, and I don't know how it happened, but my wrist started feeling better. Maybe it was the 6 months that it needed of, you know, complete rest of no tennis racket in my hand. I mean, I was so depressed. I didn't know where my tennis rackets were. They were somewhere in the basement. I hadn't seen them in 6 months. I didn't want to see. I used to never watch a tennis match because it just depressed me. You know, so everyone goes through this. I mean, when you have a 12-year-long career, which I've had, fortunately, it's, you know, you're never always going to peak. There's going to be times when you're going to be down, and I think those are the times that define you really.
We had the pleasure of having Gopishan this morning, and he mentioned that the need for having the mentors in this field of sports especially, and especially people who can help on the emotional side, the mental side. What are your take on in the field of tennis for that?
Yeah, I mean, especially I think in sports like badminton and tennis and individual sports basically, I think it's very important because it's a very lonely sport. I mean, when you're on the court, it's very lonely, you know, you have to solve your own problems, you're traveling 30 weeks a year without family, without friends. It's tough to maintain relationships, I'll tell you. I mean, you know, we're on the phone almost all the time because we're always trying to be in touch with people we, you know, love and trying to work at it and trying to... So it's difficult. It's a very lonely life, and, you know, imagine living out of the suitcase and taking a flight, you know, two flights every week, you know, for 30 weeks a year. And that's what I've been doing for the last 15 years of my life. And, you know, it doesn't look like hopefully it's going to stop anytime soon. But you need someone who's there emotionally for you. If it's one of your parents, it's great. If it's, it could be a sibling, but it could be in the form of a coach. And you know, for me, thankfully it was my parents. You know, one of them always tried to travel with me, and most of the time they still do because I prefer it that way. You know, I prefer them because it's just I mean I feel like killing myself having room service every night. You know, I don't wanna like go out and just have a meal or something. So it is very important, I think, to have a certain mentor. And But you know, I think Gopi's done a great job at what he's done and mentoring, you know, so many of them. And, you know, first Saina, and then, first of all, he himself was such an amazing player. And then with Saina and Sindhu, and now obviously with Srikanth, you know, who doesn't seem to be losing. So
he himself was surprised by Srikanth's accomplishment. I mean, that says a lot about his coaching and mentoring.
No, of course. I mean, I try not to read the newspapers. So when I'm not playing, I read them because that's the only time they don't write, you know, nonsense about me. So,
So in the world of tennis, I mean, what is your vision for the tennis? Obviously, we want you to keep going for many, many more years, but what is your vision for the tennis, if you can describe that?
My tennis or tennis in general?
Tennis in general for the...
Well, I mean, you would have thought that, you know, when I made that huge breakthrough in 2005, you know, everyone thought, oh my God, there's going to be this splash of tennis players coming out, and like it happened in China, you know, they had, all of a sudden, they had seven players in the top 100 of the world. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. You know, like I said, it comes back to the facilities, it comes back to the training. We don't have proper trainers, we don't have proper, we don't even have a sporting environment as much, you know, for to support, I mean, you know, a sport that is not cricket, you know, unfortunately. But it's changing, it's changed now, and, you know, this is the first time, actually, I must tell you, I don't know how many people know, we've never won a medal in a women's doubles match at Women's doubles at Asian Games, Commonwealth Games ever. Because, and this is the first time that we won, when we won the bronze this time. Because that just shows that, I know, I was playing with a 20-year-old girl, and you know, for me, like to play with her, it's like playing with my sister. She's the baby of the house. So it's like, you know, 8 years younger to me. But we played and we won, so obviously she was good enough. And so that obviously is a very positive sign that we're moving forward, and, you know, that we are getting better. As far as, you know, producing people at this level are concerned, I mean, I think it's still going to take some time. You know, I've started my own tennis academy to try and help. You know, I have a Sania Mirza tennis academy based out of here, about 45 minutes from the city.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah. So yeah, that's my goal. I'm so tired of answering this question. I was like, okay, finally, let me do something about it. You know, let me try and help whatever experiences I have or whatever I can.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, you started taking the action instead of waiting for something to happen.
Yeah, you know, because when you don't have a proper system in place, I mean, there's individuals that need to do it. You know, we all try and do our bit in whatever way we can. My passion is tennis, and, you know, I'd love to see more tennis players, you know, coming and playing at this level, male or female. I mean, at least in the guys, we have a slightly better future, you know, with, you know, Somdev and Saket, you know, who I want to gold medal with at the Asian Games. And so there's, but in the girls, it's tough to name, you know, a bunch of girls who would be like, okay, these girls are going to, you know, have good potential or whatever. So, yeah, I mean, I hope that it does happen, and I hope someone does come out of there. I can share whatever as a family and as a professional, whatever experiences I can share.
Yeah, it's very inspiring that, you know, in spite of you continuing to play, you are also doing so much for the promotion, and you're investing your time, money, efforts to build this kind of facilities to groom the future leaders and the future tennis players. So, you know, big congrats to you for that. We suddenly, you know, are inspired by you, and all the young Indians are inspired by you, and I'm sure the youth of the country are inspired by you, and we want you to continue to play that role model role, and you know, be with us, stay engaged with us, and you know, let us know whatever way we can support your vision and your plan. And in recognition of that, you know, we want to offer you an honorary membership to Young Indians. I hope that you will.
I think it's really cool, I must say. I mean, I think that the youth of this country is the future, and I think that it's really good that, you know, you guys come together and, you know, have these sessions, because it's not easy to, you know, speak to people who have achieved, and I think that it's, for me, it would be a great motivation to speak to people like Gopi Chand, and, you know, so I, you know, you guys are doing a great job, so congratulations, and hopefully we'll have a few more sessions.
We'll just take a couple of questions. She has a flight to catch, so we have only time for two questions.
No questions.
Can I ask a question? The mic's working. You know, you said when you started off playing, it was very difficult for, you know, for a girl to sort of play tennis. And you did mention, I guess you made an allusion to it, saying that there's not too many girls that you can name right now as well in tennis. But do you think the situation on the ground in the country is changing for tennis, you know, especially for women to sort of, for young girls to sort of start the game?
Yeah, not just the sport is kind of connected with what boys do, and playing with dolls is what connects girls. I mean, you know, that's really how it is, and that's the kind of culture that we grow up in. So, you know, when you do that, and when you say, no, but I want to play tennis, or I want to play cricket, or whatever it is, you are rebellious, which I have been named. You are out of the box, you know, there are many things. So, but it has changed a lot. I mean, of course, we move forward as a country, and I hope it's changed a lot. And I hope that today the girls don't have to always face the fact that they're going to tan and no one's going to marry them. I mean, you know, like, but I still think we have a long way to go before, you know, parents actually believe, acha, theek hai, you know, this is our daughter, and I want her to become a professional athlete, whatever it is. I mean, I've heard Mary Kom stories, I met her recently. She was saying, I mean, I was at least into a sport that was more girls do. I mean, she was into boxing. So, you can imagine where she did. So, you know, Radha was almost finishing when I started, and Steffi was the, you know, it was a great privilege actually to play with her kids and meet her, and, you know, obviously to be back, and I was like, wow, you know. So, I think that, unfortunately, I didn't have a role model in India. You know, only when I started, there was Mahesh and Leander who used to play, but as a woman, I didn't really have anyone who I would be like, oh, I want to be like her, you know. There was always, you know, I had to pick someone from outside, and for me it was Steffi.
You used to watch them, because television also was
good. I mean, at six, like, you don't really...
And so parents used to inspire
you? Yeah, I mean, you know, of course I liked playing tennis, but at six I didn't know I want to be a professional. At about 12 I thought, okay, you know, I was like, oh, I'm pretty good at this, like, you know, maybe I should give it a shot. And I used to skate and swim and play tennis. I used to do everything for a few years, and then at, you know, around 12 actually I won this tournament, I remember very clearly, which was an under 16 nationals, you know, and I was 12 years old, and I won 14 and 16 the same day, and I got my first sponsorship with Adidas, who I'm still with today, you know, at 28. So, and that day I remember saying to myself, oh, you know, I'm pretty good, I think, I should do this, maybe I can become good. So,
and what from now, like, you know, what makes you see yourself, like, you won so many?
Well, I'm sixth in the world. I'd like to be number one before I retire, hopefully.
Thank you. Very nice of you, and really, you inspired us today.
Thank you.
glad to say that you are part of YM. So,
me too. Thank you.
You can, just all the YM members would like to just have a quick picture with you. So, YM guys, you can come and just take a quick picture.